Hello and welcome to the latest in the RAA's Introduction to the Racing Rules series. And this episode is going to focus on team racing. Yes, so I'm Arthur Henderson. I'm an experienced team racer who's done sort of a few events crewing while growing up, but then I got really stuck into team racing at university and I've kept going with it since. And I've continued to team race sort of whenever and wherever I can, all around the country and abroad. And I'm really pleased today to be joined by Chris Lindsay.
Hi, Arthur. Hi, so my name's Chris Lindsay, and I'm coming to you from the other side of team racing. So I'm an umpire, and I've done quite a few team racing events up until now. I've become a World Sailing International umpire, and I'm also on World Sailing's Team Racing Rules Working Party. So that's the group that writes the rules and the calls for team racing. So hopefully, together, we'll be able to give you a bit of a brief introduction to team racing.
Sounds like we're going to be in safe hands. So today we're going to talk about the racing rules and how they apply to team racing. And here's a quick overview of how the webinar is going to go. First off, we're going to talk about what team racing is, how it works. We're going to run through two-boat, three-boat, and four-boat team racing. Talk about the tactics, the three C's of combinations, conversions, and communication, which hopefully will make a bit more sense as we go through the next few slides. We're going to give a quick overview of the course, which is important when we then talk about what Chris does, which is on the water umpiring. And then the real body of the talk will be to talk about some typical team racing situations and how the rules might differ from fleet racing. And I'm sure Chris will mention Appendix D, but also just what a team racer might do in a situation which you might not be used to or prepared for. To give an introduction to team racing, we'll start with why do we team race in the first place? Well, for me, it's the fast-paced, short, exciting races, which I really enjoy. And it's really sociable form of sailing with the ability to chat to your team and other teams onshore between races. And loads of people use it to spice up their normal racing. I'd recommend it for sort of inter-club competitions or maybe inter-classes at your own club. But it's really widely done at university level. It's especially good for sort of young people on the circuit, as you don't need to bring boats along with you to go sailing. They're provided. So sometimes you can even get to the sailing club by train, bring your sailing kit, and sort of turn up and play sailing. Starting with how does it work? There's loads of different ways of getting involved, and the easiest to organise and to understand is two versus two, which means that two boats from one team are pitted against two boats from another. This is the easiest to get to because you need the fewest people. But the most common form is three versus three, which is widely used on the Firefly team racing circuit and at university level and all over the place. You can go up to four versus four, which I know is done with Optimist team racing, and then also sort of keelboats, small keelboats with spinnakers. Those are the common formats, but if you want to go for more, we're not going to stop you. So when we talk about how do you win a team race, one word that comes up is combinations. If you're in a two versus two team race, it's very simple. The last boat across the finishing line, their team loses. So if you know that your team, or if you're in last or your teammate's in last, you need to do something about it and make sure that you get them out of last, either by slowing down an opposition boat or by sailing fast. With the three boat, that's the most common, and what you're looking for is 10 points or fewer. Well, that means sort of we talk about combinations. So first, second, and third would be a combination. If you add those three up, you've got 6 points, and that's a clear win. And the winning ones, the ones you're aiming for, are one, two, anything, one, three, anything, first, fourth, and fifth, and then second, third, and either fourth or fifth. But we'll talk about those a little bit more. On the next few slides. With four boat, it gets more complicated. As a general rule of thumb, either three boats in the top four or not the bottom two is a win. That covers most of them, but there are some where you have to start adding them up on your fingers or get the calculator up. And if you're tied on points, the team with the boat in first place loses, which is sort of to try and encourage a bit more team racing and some more maneuvers around the place. We're going to explore this a little bit further by looking at some boats crossing a finishing line. And to start with, we can see that the red team is crossing the line in first. Then there's two blue boats, one more red, a blue, and then the final red boat coming across. If we look at the combination that the red team are in, they're finishing in first, fourth, and sixth. If we add up those points, we get to 11. As we watch the blue boats come across the line, we can see they're finishing in second, third, and fifth. Adding up those, only 10 points, the blue team's going to win. You might be wondering why I've brought this up, but if we go on to the next slide, we'll be able to see that if the red team do something different, they might be able to win this time. And so you can see the focus is going to be on these two boats on the right. And these boats started in exactly the same positions as before. But this time, that red boat on the right is going to slow down the blue boat, hold them up, jib flapping into the wind, and then bear away and cross the line, but only once their teammate has crossed. Here, this is a classic example of a conversion. And the red team have converted their position from first, fourth, and sixth to now first, fourth, and fifth. Now, if we look at the points on the right, they've reduced theirs to 10. The blue team's now on 11 points, and the red team's won. This is the key concept that makes team racing different to fleet racing, because it shows that you can manipulate the overall race by slowing yourself down and slowing others to create a better overall position for the team. There is no substitute for sailing fast, but if you can get this sort of combinations working and getting them done really quickly, your team's going to be in better position by the time you get to the finishing line. So looking a bit more generally at the three boat combinations, now don't worry, I'm not going to talk through all of this table, but this sort of explains what the winning combinations are and what the losing combinations are. And if obviously one team is winning, the other team has to be losing. And it shows a little bit about how you might get, or what conversions you might do to get from your losing combination into a winning combination, or in order to improve your winning combination. And the key concept that's sort of a bit beyond the first time you team race, but you should definitely get on board with if you're going to do a lot of it, is whether you're in a stable winning combination or an unstable one. And so a good example here would be if you're in 1-3-6, which is about halfway down on the left-hand side, you're winning, you've got 1-3 anything, that's a win, that's great. But your opposition are in 2-4-5, and they know that if their boat in second slows down your boat in third, they can convert their combination into a 2-3-4 very easily, and suddenly they're winning. And they're stably winning, so you're in trouble. And so the general rule is, if you're losing, get into a winning combination as quickly as possible. And if you're winning, but in an unstable combination, try and get into a stable winning combination as quickly as possible. If we were doing this talk live, I'd ask you, what's the easiest way to overtake someone? Is it to sail fast and around them, or to slow down an opposition boat by using your wind shadow, or physically blocking them using the rules to your advantage? Now, a lot of people who haven't team raced before might say, well, it's easy, we'll just sail around them. Well, if you've done that before, and if you have done some team racing and you're against another team who's equally good, you'll know that becomes very tricky. But if you can outmaneuver your opposition, suddenly you're in a stronger place. This is where we bring the rules into team racing, and why we need umpires in some situations, because we do get close to each other, and we do keep things exciting. And so that's sort of hopefully explained to you why we might need to think about what our team's position is. I didn't even use the third big C word, which is communication. Communicate it to our team, discuss what we need to do, and then pull the conversions to improve our combination. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the standard team racing courses, which will be useful for when we talk about the different rule situations and why they might occur in different places on the course. The most commonly used is the Starboard S, or the Digital N course, depending on who you ask. And this one, you start upwind, beat up to a first mark to be left to starboard, reach across, run down, and then sort of on between marks 3 and 4 on another reach, and then beat up to the finish. And so quite often, it's a standard terminology, you could say you pull the conversion at mark three and then all of your team would know what you're talking about. You can also commonly use this the box course. Some people like it round to port, some people like it round to starboard. But ultimately, you can use any course you'd like. If you're used to windward lures, and that's what all your sailors have ever done, then I'm not stopping you. So the next thing we're going to talk about is on the water umpiring and bring Chris into our discussion. So Chris, over to you. Please can you let us know what it's all about?
Thank you very much, Arthur. That's given us a really good introduction to team racing. So I'm going to talk very briefly about how on the water umpiring works and how that is different in team racing to what you might be used to if you're a fleet racer. But this is very introductory, so don't worry too much about the finer details, but just give you a very brief overview. Overall, it's very similar to fleet racing. So it's still self-policed in the sense that as a sailor, it's your obligation to enforce the rules. The only difference is that instead of having protests in the evening, maybe after racing, we did everything on the water. And that's because, as Arthur said, we have a lot of incidents. Team racing can be very intense as a sport with a lot of incidents between boats on different teams. And if we dealt with that in the traditional way, we would spend all of our evenings in the protest room rather than in the bar or doing something else that might be a bit more fun. So we've come up with this on the water umpiring system. So it's very, very similar to fleet racing, except that those decisions don't get made in the protest room. They're now being made by the umpires on the water. So you can see here, I've said, think cricket umpire, not football referee. So the umpires don't generally get involved in the action unless you ask them. So they won't usually give you a decision unless you ask, and you do that by protesting in the normal way. The umpires will then make a decision and they can penalize rule breaches on the water with penalty turns. So those penalty turns are the same as you would have in fleet racing, pretty much exactly the same. One additional factor is that in team racing, competitors have the option of taking a smaller penalty voluntarily before the umpire has made a decision, or they can wait, in which case you risk getting a larger penalty from the umpires. So I'll say a little bit more about how that works in a bit more detail. So this is a bit of a flow diagram to show you how the umpiring works on the water and how you get a decision. So it all starts on the left-hand side with an incident that has happened on the water, a boat has broken a rule, and there are competitor protests. So that's all pretty much the same as fleet racing, except in team racing, we want you to hail protest, so that's usual, and display your red flag. So you do both of those things in order to protest. At that point, the boats in the incident have got a choice. They can take a voluntary penalty. So the boat that has broken a rule, or it's alleged they've broken a rule, has the option of taking a penalty voluntarily. And that would be one turn. So one tack and one jibe in the same direction. So exactly the same as a fleet racing turn. But it's only one. So it's a relatively small penalty. So if you take it voluntarily, then the incident is closed and there's no further action. If the boat that is alleged to have broken a rule has not taken a voluntary penalty, then the umpires will signal a decision. And this is all happening pretty quickly, so only in a few seconds. If nothing happens, then the umpires will make a decision. And they basically have, there's two possible outcomes that the umpires may signal. One is a green and white flag, as you can see here, that signals that there is no penalty. And the alternative is a red flag, which is a penalty. And now it's two turns. So if the umpires blow the whistle and point their red flag at you, that is a two turns penalty. So it's twice as much, arguably a bit more than twice actually, to do two turns. So it's a hard penalty. So that's really how the on the water umpiring works. The umpires will penalize any boat that broke a rule and did not take a penalty. So really we'd encourage you, if you know you've broken a rule, it is much better to take that penalty yourself when it's only going to be one turn, rather than waiting for the umpires to signal a decision.
Chris, I definitely agree. Taking one turn in a team race is, it feels like, definitely less than half as bad as taking two turns. Two turns really quite often puts you right to the back. Yeah, Chris, you said that penalty turns must be taken immediately. What if there's another boat coming towards you?
Sure. So when I say immediately, you do have an obligation to first get clear. So you have to, first of all, sail away from the action to make sure that when you start your penalty turn, you're not going to be in anybody's way, essentially. So you need to sail clear and then complete your penalty. And the umpires will give you a little bit of time to do that. We understand that if there's a lot of boats together, that might take you a few seconds to do that, no problem. You cannot delay your penalty in the sense of, say, in match racing, where you can delay it until the finish. So in some other disciplines of sailing, that is allowed. In team racing, you have to take it pretty much straight away. So as soon as the umpires put up that red flag and point at you, we're going to be looking for some action. But we will consider the fact that you do need to sail well clear first.
What if I saw a boat was doing a penalty? Could I sail towards them and try and interfere?
That's a good question. So the answer is no. Once another boat has started taking their penalty, so once they've started that first tack or that first jibe, the other boats around them also have an obligation not to interfere. So it is a bit of a balance. The boat taking a penalty has an obligation to get well clear, first of all, and the other boats have an obligation not to interfere with the boat that's taking a penalty. But obviously, sometimes what can happen is if the boat that is taking a penalty hasn't sailed well clear in the first place and the other boats interfere, then that will be a problem for the boat that was taking a penalty.
Oh, thanks.
Great. That's pretty much how the umpiring works in nearly all of the cases that happen. There are, however, some instances where the umpires will penalise you without a protest from another boat. These are quite limited. In general, the umpires don't get involved without a protest. But here are the list of exceptions. If you hit a mark, or if you hit your teammate, so if you make contact with a mark of the course, or two boats on the same team touch each other, then the umpires will step in and penalise one of the boats if they don't take a penalty themselves. Another one is if you break rule 42, so that is the propulsion rule. If you pump, rock, or scull, or otherwise you propel the boat in some way that's not allowed by rule 42, that will also be an umpire-initiated penalty. And then there's two more. If you break a rule and gain an advantage, so often what can happen is you can break a rule, and as a result of breaking the rule, you end up in a better position than you would have been if you hadn't broken the rule. This happens very often at marks and things like that. We have this rule in there so that the umpires can make sure that even in that scenario where you broke a rule, you took a penalty, but you were still ahead of where you would have been, then the umpires will penalise you again in order to remove that advantage. And then also if you commit a breach of sportsmanship, so that's, for example, breaking a rule deliberately would fall under that category, committing a breach of sportsmanship. And there are some other rarer cases, so I've referenced the rule here. But this is really just to give you a bit of an introduction to some of the main reasons why you would get a penalty without a protest. And there are some other exceptions. And as I said before, any penalty the umpires give you, unless they tell you otherwise, it's two turns. So it's the same thing applies here. If you get a red flag from the umpires, it will be two turns. Now, I'm going to say a little bit about the rules before we talk about some of the scenarios that are common in team racing. Often when people see the rule book, they can recoil in horror, but don't worry, we're just going to mention a few very brief points, and we're not going to go into the rules in any great depth. So the rules get published every 4 years by World Sailing, and there's a special appendix, which Arthur has already mentioned, which is specifically for team racing, and that's Appendix D. So the way the rule book is structured is you have the main rule book at the front, and then you have appendices that are labeled with a letter and they all refer to different specialist disciplines. So team wrestling is one of those, and our appendix is Appendix D. And if you look at that appendix, it will tell you how the rules are different for team wrestling versus flea wrestling. So it's a very short appendix as well. We will highlight the rules that are different between team wrestling and flea wrestling. If you would like a bit more information about the rules and to go into them in a little bit more detail, I provided you here with a link to a webinar series on the wrestling rules, where there are 6 webinars, and they're each about half an hour long, and they'll go through different sections of the rules, so you can really take a bit of a deep dive and go into those rules in much more detail than we're going to do now. But really, we're only going to focus on the very basics and on those incidents that are common to team wrestling. And then finally, before we talk about some incidents, it's useful to point out to you that in addition to publishing the rules, World Sailing also publishes this thing called the Call Book. So this is a book which is a list or a sort of catalogue of incidents that are common to team wrestling, and you'll find that there's a question and an answer for each of these. So they will look at common incidents, there'll be some facts that describe it, there'll be a diagram, and the call book will tell you how the rules apply in that incident. So it's obviously quite a long book, and I don't suggest that you read the whole thing unless you're really having trouble sleeping at night, but it can be a really useful reference for you to look up something that might have happened to you on the water. If you are a bit confused about how the rules apply to a certain situation, you can look it up and see if it's in the call book. That will give you an authoritative answer as to how the rules are applied in that situation. And I've also provided you a link so that you can look it up for yourself. So now we're going to apply what we've just talked about, and we're going to look at some common incidents that happen in team wrestling. I'm going to be asking Arthur for his insight into the tactics and why you might try to pull off a certain maneuver, or why this might be useful for the boats involved. And then we'll talk a little bit about how the rules apply to those incidents and what the umpires are looking for when they're making a decision, so that you can best avoid getting a penalty and turn some of your losing combinations into winning combinations, as Arthur has talked about. So this is the first incident, which we've called barging at the start. So we've got 2 boats, blue and yellow, who are both approaching the starting line in the few seconds before the start. So you can see our diagram here, and our committee boat is in orange. And what happens is that blue luffs and forces yellow to sail on the wrong side of the committee boat. So we pose the question first, is this allowed? And then we'll talk a bit about what the obligations are on each of the boats. So Arthur, has this ever happened to you? And how do you handle this kind of scenario?
Well, I've definitely been both boats in this situation, but you'd rather be the blue one. If you're the yellow boat, you're being held high off that start line. And I don't want to preempt your answer to your question, but it is allowed, and yellow's not going to have a good time here. You definitely want to be blue boat starting on time.
So definitely, I agree with you. Yellow is not going to be having a good time in this scenario. So if we think about how the rules apply, in position 1, the boats are on the same tack and they're overlapped. So that means that the windward boat has to keep clear. So that's going to be yellow. So as Arthur says, yellow's in a bit of trouble here. She is the keep clear boat. She's obliged to keep clear of blue. Likewise, we know that if you're a right-of-way boat, you're not free to exercise those rights without regard for the other boat. You have to give them a bit of room to keep clear. And in this case, I would say blue has done that because she has luffed slowly. She's given yellow some room to keep clear. Yellow has been able to maneuver and keep clear. So I would say this is absolutely fine. And as we know, the rules around mark room and things like that don't apply at the committee boat when you're approaching it to start. So this is very simply a windward leeward. What I think you have to avoid if you're blue in this scenario is leaving that luff too late, to the point where yellow has effectively got her bow overlapped with the committee boat and blue, And then she's trapped. She will not be able to bail out. She'll be forced to hit the committee vote. And if Blue forces her to do that, then Blue will not have given room to keep clear. And that would instead be a penalty on Blue. So I think if you're Blue in this scenario, this can be really useful, but you do have to be quite careful and that you time your luff appropriately and you give Yellow room to keep clear. So our second scenario is a port starboard. So I'm sure this is very familiar to you if you're a fleet racer, but obviously these incidents do happen as well in a team race. And I think they can be quite common given that we have six boats on what's a relatively small course. So how often would you say this happens, Arthur?
This is another common one, but it's can be a little bit ambiguous. So I'm interested to hear what you'll say about how you're going to decide who's in the right or who's in the wrong.
So which boat is going to be the right-of-way boat here?
The blue one's on starboard and the yellow one's on port. So I'm going for the blue one.
Absolutely. So this is a very clear port starboard. And blue is going to be the right-of-way boat on starboard and port. The yellow is the keep clear boat because she's on port. And effectively, what the umpires are going to be looking at is the gap in between the boats. And they're going to be trying to make a decision as to whether Blue had to take avoiding action. So is it that she is genuinely having to change course to avoid a collision with Yellow? Or is it a bit of a Hollywood maneuver and she's trying to convince us that Yellow wasn't keeping clear when in fact she was? So that's really always what you're trying to decide. And the rules tell us that this will effectively be a penalty on the yellow boat if Blue had a reasonable apprehension of a collision. So do you think as the umpire that there would have been a reasonable chance of a collision if Blue hadn't changed course? That's a summary, essentially, of what we would be thinking about. So you're sort of asking yourself, what would happen if Blue hadn't changed course? It's slightly difficult to tell from these diagrams how you would call it, but on the water, taking into account the conditions and things like that, that would really be what we're looking for.
Yeah, that's quite interesting from the sailor's point of view, because quite often a lot of people have been in the yellow boat and they've seen the blue do a course alteration and then thought, well, they didn't really need to. And you can imagine how if there wasn't an on-the-water umpire right there, it would create a bit of ambiguity and there might be, not say bad blood, but there'd be discussions about whether or not they'd had to. You can see the advantage of having an umpire right there. They're going to make the right call most of the time, and you've just got to trust them.
Absolutely. I would definitely agree with that. And you can see as well, as Arthur says, I completely agree with that. There is a massive advantage to having the umpire there because the decision is being made by somebody that saw the incident. You're not having to try and convince a protest committee of your version of the facts. You actually have somebody that saw it. And I should mention that if the umpires did not see the incident, sometimes we will miss things, then they will not be giving a penalty. So in team racing and all umpired sports, or all umpired disciplines of sailing anyway, you will not get a penalty unless the umpires are sure that you broke a rule. So you definitely have that advantage. Great. So an incident that's a bit related to that. Now our boats have reached mark one, which is the first mark of the course that Arthur talked about, our digital N. And here, Yellow enters the zone clear ahead. And shortly after, she tacks onto port to go around the mark. And Blue changes course to avoid her. So what are you thinking about this incident, Arthur?
Well, I think you've done this GIF really well, because it's again, a little bit ambiguous. And the answer is, I think, it depends. Initially, if you're the yellow boat, you're clear ahead entering the zone. And so the blue boat has to give you, I'm sure you'll use the correct terminology, but room to sail to the mark, which is what you take. But as soon as you go through head to wind, you become boats on opposite tacks. And then I'm hoping you're going to take over here and use the correct terminology, because then it looks a little bit less good for yellow.
Well, I can tell you, you're absolutely using the right terminology. So the key here is, first of all, we've said that yellow enter the zone Claire had. So from position one, she's going to be entitled to mark room. So hopefully that's relatively clear cut. Then, as you said, yellow passes head to wind. And at that point, basically what happens is that mark room rule switches off because we've now got two boats on opposite tacks on a beat to windward. And the rules say that the mark room rule does not apply. So it effectively becomes a port starboard. So there is basically, it's like there's no mark there at all from that point on. So it's just a question of, did yellow keep clear? So she's obligated to keep clear, but when she passes head to wind because she's tacking, and then when she reaches close hold, she's on port now, so she still keep clear boat. So that's really the question for the umpires is, did blue have to change course to avoid yellow? Did yellow fail to keep clear? So it's exactly the same considerations as we mentioned in the previous slide. But I think this incident is quite common. You can see in team racing. So we see this pretty much all the time. But the rules that apply are actually quite straightforward.
I definitely agree. It was a common situation. And we train for it quite a lot. If you're the yellow boat, the trick is sort of one you might have heard before. It's a little bit of in wide, out tight. And you want to go past the mark with your boat head to wind and keep going straight head to wind until your transom is level with the mark. And if you do that a little bit like this gif, but maybe go a little bit further, once your transom is level with the mark, the blue boat can no longer get inside you and they're forced to go outside you, and then you can tack away. Hopefully that makes a bit of sense. But the key for that one is to practice it.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. So I think that's definitely a great point. The more you practice these maneuvers, the better you're going to become at them, and the more confident you'll be at using the rules to your advantage. So speaking of using the rules to your advantage, we have a look at this scenario. So now we've carried on across the reach to mark number two. So maybe you want to talk us through this one, Arthur. This is a bit more tactical.
Yes. So you can imagine if this was the front end of a race, coming into the situation, the blue boat's in the lead, but the yellow boat, let's say, has got a piece. They can do something about that. And in this case, they luff the blue boat a little bit, and they actually make a really good conversion from second and third into what looks like it might be first and second pretty soon. The question, I'm sure you'll tell us a little bit more about, is this move allowed? If it is, then it's fantastic. Do you want to run through it, and then I'll say what you might try and do if you're each of the boats in this situation?
Absolutely. So this is a sort of another variant of the same kind of rules we talked about at the start. So it's going to be that rule about keeping clear if you're overlapped, if you're the windward boat, and your obligation if you're the leeward boat when you change course to give other boats room to keep clear. So that's the first bit of the rules that apply. So you can see in this diagram, all the maneuvers seem to be quite smooth and seamanlike. Blue has been given plenty of room to keep clear, and the teammate. So that has given a nice opportunity for the inside yellow to go into that gap. So there's no problem with that. One thing you do have to watch out for, though, is especially if you're the middle yellow boat in this scenario, I have not shown in my diagram how that overlap was established. So you probably will know this rule 17, this rule that obliges you not to sail above your proper course if you got an overlap from clear astern within two of your hull lengths. So if that was the case, and the umpires would have to be alert to that, that if that's how yellow, the middle yellow, got her overlap, then she would be breaking that rule because she's sailing further, she's sailing above her proper course, sort of from position two onwards. But assuming that's not the case, then this move would be allowed. And we do see it it's quite common actually. And for the reasons that you suggest, it's a really great way to do a conversion and get into that 1-2 that is a solid winning combination.
Yes, so the yellow boats are doing well here. The defense, which is a little bit more in depth, so I'll only skim over it here, is that if you're the blue boat, you want to do a reasonably fast and aggressive luff when you're initially luffed, and that's when you, as I say, break the overlap. And so you end up clear ahead of yellow, if only briefly, which means when you bear away back onto a reach, yellow boat just inside you will have gained their overlap from behind and suddenly be restricted by rule 17. And that's sort of a good way of forcing the race on and preventing you from getting luffed any further. Again, that's something that requires a lot of practice. And actually, I'd like to ask you a little bit about this, Chris. If you're sort of, you see this incident and the blue boat tries to break the overlap, and you're not really sure if they have or they haven't, then there's, you know, the yellow boat saying you haven't and the blue boat saying you have. As the umpire there, if you're not also sort of a bit unsure, what happens then?
Great question. So we as umpires, we have a principle, which is we assume that the situation has not changed until we are certain that it has. So in this case, we would assume that the overlap is not broken until we are sure that it has been broken. And that's really to allow some consistency in the rules. So we go back to what's called the last point of certainty, is what we call that. So we would not consider the overlap broken unless we are sure. And I can tell you from experience, this is a very difficult thing to see, particularly at this mark. It's going to be very difficult to see if that overlap is broken, just purely from where the umpire boats are generally positioned. The sailboats are going in quite a tight circle, so they're maneuvering quite quickly. And us umpires on our ribs can't quite maneuver that fast. So that is something to bear in mind. The umpires will be unlikely to see that overlap broken. I should also mention, it is possible, depending on the size of the boats, that the inside yellow boat could be breaking that rule 17 with respect to the outside boat, and because obviously they're all overlapped. But in this scenario we've drawn, I think the inside yellow boat is sailing her proper course. The rounding is not, she's not taking more room than necessary, and she hasn't really sailed her proper course, I would say. So in this case, that doesn't apply, but something to bear in mind as well. So another sort of version of that incident we talked about, often you can see this after the boats have gone around the mark. So do you want to take us through this, Arthur?
Yeah, so a bit of an interesting one, and this definitely comes up quite a lot. And you've called it closing the door, which is exactly what that blue boat's trying to do. So when the blue boat hits the zone, the yellow boat is not overlapped with it, the yellow boat inside it. And so must thereafter give blue mark room. And so the question is, how long do they keep having to give them mark room for? And I'll throw that one back over to you, Chris, because I'm hoping you're going to tell me.
So this is pretty much the same kind of thing as we've already been talking about. So you're absolutely right. Yellow is obligated to give blue some mark room. I think actually this is also just a simple kind of case of not giving room to keep clear. So in this scenario, the inside yellow is not entitled to mark room. So she has to give blue room to round the mark. And you can read more about that in the definition of mark room in the rules. But essentially she needs to give blue enough room to round the mark, which I would argue that she's done. Blue is now sailing what would be away from her proper course, directly downwind. But more importantly, when blue jibes onto starboard here, she needs to give that inside yellow boat some room to keep clear, because those rules still apply. Even though the mark room rules are applying at the same time, the right of way rules apply all of the time. So there's still an obligation to give that inside yellow boat some room to keep clear. So if blue does that, and the inside yellow is slow at responding, then it's going to be a penalty on that inside yellow boat. If blue does not give her room to keep clear and, for example, forces contact or forces the yellow boat to hit the mark, then it's going to be a penalty on blue because she needs to give room to keep clear. So it's a really nice example of, even though the mark room rules might not be in your favor, so inside yellow is not entitled to mark room, she still has those protections of rule 16, so of the rule that limits you if you're the right-of-way boat.
Looking at this from a team racer's point of view, if you're that blue boat, You've got to think a little bit about your sort of risk reward. If you go for a aggressive jibe and a sharp luff at the yellow boat, you're sort of possibly putting it into the umpire's hands and putting yourself vulnerable. Whereas if you just jibe with that yellow boat jibe inside you, you don't need to luff them. You've got complete control of them. If you're going downwind and your opposition boat, if you're going downwind on starboard, and your opposition boat is to the right of you, also on starboard, you're in control. You can choose when to luff them. You can choose how to slow them. You're all in all sorts of good places. Whereas if you go for an aggressive luff straight away and throw things into the hands of the umpire, you could be in a bit of trouble.
Definitely agree with that. And certainly I would say that trying to avoid contact and damage is 100% something that you should do. If you're in an incident that causes some damage, even if you were the boat that was in the right, even if the on the water rules were in your favor, you can still find yourself getting a points penalty or a deduction from your damage deposit, even worse, because you didn't avoid contact. So you have an obligation all of the time to avoid contact and damage. And so that is something you need to bear in mind as well. The umpires will not look favorably on anything that involves contact and damage that could have been avoided. So now we have a slightly different incident. We've gotten as far as mark three now, and we've got the three boats approaching the mark like this. So the reason that I've included this one is to point out a rule that you might as a fleet racer be familiar with, but actually it doesn't exist for team racing. That's rule 18.4. If you're into your rule numbers, you don't necessarily have to be. But that is the rule which in a fleet race would require the inside yellow boat here to jibe at the mark. So she couldn't sail further than the mark than needed in a fleet race. In team racing, we have deleted that rule. So this move is completely legal. The inside yellow boat can sail as long as she wants. She's going to be the inside right-of-way boat. So she's going to be entitled to mark room. She's overlapped, and she's also going to be right of way because she's leeward. So provided she doesn't have any proper course restriction or anything like that, there is nothing that requires her to go around the mark. And the proper course restriction that I'm alluding to is the same as what we just discussed. If she gets an overlap to leeward of another boat, then two of her hull lengths. So that's the normal rule 17. But there is no mark room rule that requires her to jibe or go around this mark. So just something else to bear in mind. This is a really great tactic for the middle yellow to try and get her teammate three. So I don't know if you'd like to say anything about that, Arthur, as well.
No, I think that's all well explained. Yeah, happy with that one.
Perfect. So then we can move on to what is our final scenario. So now we've gone as far as mark number four. There's another reach, if you remember the course that Arthur talked about. And this maneuver we do see quite commonly in three-on-three, and it also happens with optimists quite a bit. So you can see yellow gets to the zone of mark number four clear ahead. So she's entitled to mark room. All's fine there. Then she jibes on to starboard. So she's going to be going from clear ahead to starboard, and she sails directly at the blue boat that's beneath her. And then the question is, what are the obligations? So here, this is pretty similar. Now, although we don't have two on opposite tacks, as I said earlier, the right-of-way rules still apply. So even though yellow is entitled to mark room, she's still gonna have to give blue some room to keep clear. So this incident is all gonna be about whether blue had room to keep clear. Was there anything blue could do to keep clear from the time that yellow was creating a collision course, essentially? So for the umpires, the real killer point here is, when did yellow stop changing her course and holding her course? So you can see here that yellow is changing course all the time, which means that she has a continuing obligation to give room to keep clear. She's constantly changing her course. If, on the other hand, yellow can do this maneuver point at blue and then hold her course, you have a much better chance of the umpires thinking that blue just didn't respond or was late and giving a penalty to blue in this scenario. So, do you know what your feelings are, Arthur?
Well, yes, this the jive back, or the smackdown as it's known in Scotland, is a really popular move and it's really powerful. But as Chris says, you don't want to overdo it. So if you keep steering and put yourself in danger, you might end up at the wrong end of the umpire's red flag. But yes, good question there. Why might you try this move? You can imagine if the yellow can hold the blue and force the blue to turn the opposite direction to the way it wants to go and jibe, you're very likely to be able to slow down that blue boat and possibly get a teammate through. So yeah, this is definitely a fan favourite, this one. But it's one you have to be a little bit careful with.
Absolutely. This is a fantastic way to damage a boat, I think, to get a T-bone. So if you're going to do this, you really do have to be careful. So it's all about, as the yellow boat there, creating a collision course and then holding your course. So not being so direct that you give the blue boat no opportunity to keep clear. You have to be holding your course and give the blue boat the opportunity. And then only if she fails to take it, and she doesn't keep clear, will it be a penalty on blue in that scenario. And in this case, the umpires are going to be considering what were blue's options. So if blue has two options, she can either keep clear by, in this case, luffing or carrying on or bearing away. If she has been given at least one of those options, then that will be fine. As the yellow boat, you only have to give her one option. She doesn't have, you have to give her all the options in the world. If she takes a bad option, then it will be a failure of her to keep clear. So we're going to finish our talk with some real footage that's come from a high level team racing event. So you're going to see a lot of what we just talked about put into action. So hopefully that's given you a bit of a flavour of how exciting team racing can be on the water. It can be intense, a lot of stuff happening at once, but it is incredibly exciting. Hopefully you were able to spot some of the manoeuvres that we've talked about. You might have been able to see a blue boat that could enter the zone of Mark 3 there and clear ahead and then push two white boats out around her to get a teammate through. So that's a manoeuvre that we talked about. And you could maybe spot some other manoeuvres as well. Do you know what you thought of that incident, Arthur?
Yeah, definitely very hectic and interesting to see almost all the boats in a very small bit of water at the same time. But you'll notice they're all sailing very well, not getting too close to each other, no contact with any other boats. Everyone was very sensible and avoided contact. And then as they sailed away from the mark, they shouted protest, raised their red flags, and I think I can see the umpire reaching for a flag in the bottom of their rib there. What is the call? I think we'll leave that up to you.
Absolutely. So if you're watching this, we'd love to hear what you think the call ought to be in this scenario. I'm certainly not going to give my opinion based on that. It's very difficult to do it from drone footage, I can tell you. But hopefully that's given you a bit of a flavour of how exciting team racing can be, both as a sailor and as an umpire.
So thanks for taking us through all that, Chris. It's been really interesting to see how much knowledge you've got and let us know what the umpire can do and what they're thinking about in every stage of the situation. And hopefully this is going to stay online as a permanent resource for people to look at if they're looking at getting involved in team racing and want to know more about how the rules apply. Talking of which, if you are interested in getting involved in team racing, there is nothing stopping you just going for it. Just start as you'd like, get 4 boats from your local club and go for it, enjoy it. If you'd like to get in contact with an umpire to help you out, that's available through the RYA. And there's a sort of an active team racing circuit. So you can see the links on the website here. There's a calendar on the UCTRA website. And there's also a calendar for non-university sailing on the Boozer website. Get involved and try and enjoy it.
Thank you very much, Arthur. It's been a pleasure talking with you about team racing through this talk. I would just second everything you said. Absolutely encourage you to get involved in team racing. Particularly from my perspective, we're always looking for more umpires to be volunteering at events, and we'd love to see you there. If you're interested in hearing a little bit more about how umpiring works or learning a bit more, I would really encourage you to attend one of the RYA's umpiring courses. You've got a link here where you can get a bit of information about that. I absolutely encourage you to do that. If you have any questions and anything that's occurred to you through your talk, or if you have any questions about becoming an umpire or anything like that, we would absolutely encourage you to send it in to the email address that's here, raceofficials@rya.org.uk. And Jackie Roberts will certainly be in touch with you to answer any of your questions. And we'll be happy to answer your questions as well. They'll get forwarded on to us. So I'd really encourage you to do that. So thank you very much for listening. We hope you find this presentation useful, and we look forward to seeing you on the water sometime in the near future. Thank you very much and goodbye.